So tell me a little bit about you. What do you do?
I'm kind of a result of a life path that was very non-traditional, we'll say. I started my first business when I was 17, and I started doing, we'll call it consulting for lack of a better term. I got to my mid-30s in three companies that I had helped, you know, push north of 30, 40 million. They started almost destroying themselves internally because a lot of partners, a lot of moving parts, a lot of money, you know, people started wanting to get greedy or slam on the gas or mess with culture or mess with commission. That's either I'm going to do this for me at some point or I'm never going to, and I'm going to be in my 50s wondering why I never got started.
Hey, it's JB Brown with Build to Sell, and as always, I'm so excited to bring to you an opportunity to hear a chat with a guest that I have who's in it, been doing it for a long time, and is just in the fight doing the things that all of us have to do in order to make business work. And so today, my guest is Jacob Stahler. Jacob, thanks for hanging out with us, man.
No problem, man.
So Jacob, tell us a little bit about, and it's funny, Jacob and I had a pre sort of chat conversation, and I can relate to what he was saying, but he said he's a little bit of an enigma because he's not a super public guy. And a lot of the folks that I talk to in the business world are like that. But because of that, I don't know a lot about you other than some general. So tell me a little bit about you. What do you do?
Honestly, I'm kind of a result of a life path that was very non-traditional, we'll say. I started my first business when I was 17, and I started doing, we'll call it consulting for lack of a better term, but I would go into places and basically fix what was broken. Started with marketing, went into sales stuff, eventually coaching C-suites and fixing regions or taking people public or whatever. And so along that path, you get to work under a lot of very bright people. I got to work alongside in one of the marketing or the sales things where I was fixing the company. I worked next to the guy that came up with the Orbitz chick, the one who does the smile thing, has the accent, whatever. And so that was one of the cool experiences that I got doing what I was doing. I got to my mid-30s in three companies that I had helped, you know, push north of 30, 40 million. They started almost destroying themselves internally because a lot of partners, a lot of moving parts, a lot of money. You know, people started wanting to get greedy or slam on the gas or mess with culture, mess with commissions, whatever. And so I was like, okay, that's either I'm going to do this for me at some point or I'm never going to, and I'm going to be in my 50s wondering why I never got started.
Yeah.
And so I told my girlfriend, who's my wife now, I was like, the next thing I get offered where I think I can manage it in 30 hours a week, I'm going. I don't care where it is. You don't have to come if you don't want to. But I have to go and I need to figure out my own thing. And it took me down to Texas in Haltom City. And it was a law firm that did some bankruptcy. They were smaller. I think they were doing 700 grand a year or something when I got down there. Year and a half later, trending at close to 4 million, I think. And one of the son-in-law was using the revenue that we were generating on the bankruptcy side to try and build a personal injury lead generation company.
Makes sense.
Decided to choose California, of all states, to do lead gen out of the gate, which is the most expensive state to do personal injury lead gen in by 4x.
For any business.
Yeah, I mean, you're per actionable lead in California back at this time, $1,500 to $1,700 in spend for one. You could choose any other state and do it for cheaper.
And certainly not 100% close rate. So your average cost per lead is enormous.
Through the roof. And, you know, so they were coming to me and they were complaining about cash flow in like early fall, which when you're doing bankruptcies on payment plans, these people are broke. You're approaching Christmas time. They're going to pay $20 a month. But the methodology behind it is you have them in your system. They're paying you something. When they get their taxes back, they piss out any file, start over again. And so, you know, they were coming down and they were like, we're losing money here. We're doing this. I'm like, this has been the same. This is why you brought me here, was for this business model. And we're losing money down in Houston. Yeah. Like, because we cash out in March. This is the model and you're overspending on the back end. So I literally backed my truck up to the front door, threw all my stuff in the back of my pickup and took it over to a gym that I owned. So I had a gym. I had med spas, tanning salons, whatever.
Love med spas.
Yeah, and that's how I broke into I guess what my big company is now. But I don't have any brick and mortars anymore. During COVID, I walked away from everything. They were all lease renewal years. So obviously I can't sell it. We're closed. People thought I was crazy for walking, but I mean, a tanning salon might generate $60,000 a year. You know, if you do good, it's recurring revenue. It's a little bit hands-off, but the staff that you employ, they're difficult to manage. They're not high caliber. They don't show up all the time. So if you break down the amount of time that you're spending to make that $60,000 a year, and I had four of them, it just wasn't worth it. And if I was going to sell it, what's someone going to give me for it? $100,000, you know? And so I broke off and just started going down the telehealth medical stuff. We do pop-up clinics in like 90-something cities. There's a lot of stuff going on, a lot of layers that'll get built into it. But I'm building that to exit at the moment. There's a SaaS piece that'll get developed. We're already being approached by some private equity. I'm kind of at a point, you know, 6 years down the road that I'm ready to chairman of the board kind of thing. I don't like waking up at 2 a.m. and ads are broken on Facebook and I got to run out to my desk. I just don't. I'm at a point right now where the business model works. The layers are proven. I want to cash out, you know, the controlling portion of my equity and ride the wave to, you know, 70, 80 million EBITDA and let them sell it for, you know, a billion plus and take my 9 or 10 figures and, you know, disappear into the wind.
Now, what niche, because I know the medical space pretty well, coincidentally, what niche did you find was a great niche? Because the whole concept of pop-up clinics is intriguing to me and telehealth. What niche did you find to be the, everything has friction, because obviously that's why we get paid, is we're trying to find friction and eliminate it. But what friction point did you find that model solved really well?
Hours. We operate second shift. So people can come see us at lunch. They can come see us after work. I think the biggest friction point in telehealth is you're not tangible. So your company doesn't actually exist. You know, look at Hims, for example. They're massive, or Ro.co. They're very big. A lot of people are very hesitant to do business with them because you can't touch it. You know what I mean? You can't walk into somewhere and see their staff, you know, and they're all doing things by committee. You know, they're outsourcing a lot of stuff. You may not talk to the same doctor twice. And so it's kind of it's messy a little. And so what we found is if there's ways to be tangible, people are more likely to use your telehealth products because they can touch it. You know, if for whatever reason they're unhappy with the situation, they know that there's somewhere around there that happens regularly. They can walk in and complain if they want. Not to say that I've ever dealt with that, but I feel like it's just one of those, I don't know, safety things that people just prefer to know that someone is there. And so we've kind of turned that, and it's, don't get me wrong, dude, it took me a lot of time to get it right. It was very expensive. And that's why I'm very open about my business model. Cause if you think you can do it better than me, I'd love to see it. it's when I tell people about this, they're like, how did you even come up with that?
Huh.
And, no one else would want to start it because it just isn't, it wouldn't be profitable immediately.
Yeah.
Someone would buy it though.
Yeah.
And there's plenty of people that compete in my space in similar fashions. You know, they'll set up for 2 hours at some spot and then bounce across town and set up at a gym or whatever. And, you know, they don't have marketing spend like I do. And I spend close to $1 million a year just on Facebook marketing for that specifically. You know, a lot of the places doing pop-up clinics or internal health stuff intermittently aren't doing $1 million a year gross, let alone spending that on marketing.
Now, is this mostly, you know, meat and potatoes, internal medicine, primary care, or is there some other component to it?
It's more wellness based. We're trying to be preventive.
Okay.
We work on vitamin balancing, amino acids, hormone therapy, weight management stuff that's like accountability based.
Yeah.
There's quite a bit of stuff that we do that's before you would go and see someone about medicine. In fact, I had a phone call yesterday, and I don't answer the clinic phone very often, but occasionally if I'm not doing anything, I will. Kind of keeps me close to it. I don't know. And I'm on the phone with a guy, and he's like, yeah, I'm depressed. I'm on medication. I'm like, have you been clinically diagnosed? He was like, well, yeah. He goes, but I didn't have any issues with depression until COVID. And he's like, and so they think I have long COVID. He's like, and I'm on antidepressants now. And I was like, wait a minute. I was like, did you do any labs? And he's like, why? I'm like, long COVID's pretty synonymous with tank and vitamin D. Vitamin D is linked heavily with depression, sadness, whatever. I was like, have you had your labs done? He's like, well, yeah. I'm like, what were your labs forever ago? My vitamin D was usually like 40, 42, upper level normal. You could push 50.
Yeah.
And I was like, what are your recent labs? Well, let me go check. 22.
Oof.
And I'm like, I understand why when you go to a PCP and you tell them that you're depressed, if you go and talk to a therapist and you tell them that you're depressed and that you had thoughts of personal injury, right? They're immediately going to prescribe you medication.
Yep.
Because they're going to save their license. They're not going to be like, no, we're not going to give you antidepressants. You go home and kill yourself. Now your license is on the chopping block because you didn't do what you were supposed to and they told you they were suicidal. And I told him that. And I was like, it's not an objective stance because they're going to go the full extent to make sure that they cover their own ass too. It isn't necessarily about diagnosing you. If you tell them that you're depressed and you've had thoughts of hurting yourself, they're going to go to whatever treatment stops that. It isn't going to be like, let's get experimental. Let's check your vitamin D. That isn't going to be the way that they go. And so I told him, I was like, one, where did this all start? And it started at a PCP's office. I was like, secondly, when you said that, did they do any labs at all? He was like, not really. They checked my B12 or whatever. And I'm like, B12 is not linked to depression. So it's not, that wouldn't even be the right panel to choose. And, so we got, I talked to the guy for like an hour. And he was like, he goes, the antidepressants give me headaches, like migraines. He's like, I don't feel disconnected on the one that I'm taking. So I told him, I'm like, some antidepressants, feeling nothing is worse than feeling all of it. And he was like, 100%. He goes, there were other drugs that they put me on Lexapro. He was like, I just felt like I was alive. He's like, nothing else. I couldn't feel anything else. He was like, on this one, I don't have the same issues. But I was talking to him about, going in and making sure his D levels were low and then trying to push him into the 40s and then talk to his PCP about just dialing back his antidepressants. Because if you can split the difference, he could start deciding whether or not he feels better. Because if he does, and it is a vitamin D deficiency thing, they can pull the antidepressant and they can focus for a month or two on just this vitamin D deficiency because he won't hard shift, the whole way. And I kept telling him, I'm like, I don't have your labs. I can't diagnose you. I'm not a doctor. I was like, what I'm talking about is speculative and it's based on results we've seen we see about 6,000 patients a month. And I was like, this isn't the first time I've talked about long COVID and depression. And every time we've done it, it's everybody has low vitamin D. And he's like, well, I got a new PCP. My new PCP is telling me to be in the sun and take this multivitamin. And I'm like, sounds like this doctor's probably going more in the direction that I was talking about. And I was like, not to say that the other one was wrong. I don't know you. I don't know your health file. I don't know anything about you. But my guesstimate would be it would be linked. And that's like the core value of why we exist.
Yeah. The long COVID thing is an interesting one. So getting into the weeds here of this podcast, but for those that don't know, my degree was actually in clinical psychology and I spent 10 years in the medical field in all different roles. And the last half of that, I was essentially a fixer. So your earlier part of your story about your sort of origin and how you got to where you are now, that's sort of what I heard was you're just sort of a fixer. And when you have that personality, you're always trying to figure out where are the friction points and the broken pieces and what's the most efficient, direct way to alleviate those things. Long COVID is an interesting one to me because, yes, there is a certainly a biochemical issue with some people, but the number of folks who are suffering from depression, low energy, anxiety, any number of issues afterwards, it can't be explained by that. So to me, a couple things happen. I think you dead on nailed it with vitamin D. The other is energy. A lot of folks are starting to realize, so like a doctor checks for B12 or other B vitamins. The problem with that is it only tells you if there is an issue with either the body processing it or the levels. What it doesn't tell you, and very few primary care physicians will run this test, it doesn't tell you if you have the MTHFR mutation. And for those who don't know, the MTHFR, it's just some of us, and I have it, some of us genetically have a difficult time processing B vitamins naturally. And so you have to take a different kind of B vitamin. It's called a methylated version of the vitamin, and your body will process that better. Your energy levels will come back. But the piece that I don't hear enough people talking about is, to me, the common sense piece, which is what did we do during COVID? I don't care who you were, for the most part.
Literally stayed inside.
You stayed inside, and whether you, hopefully you had a family that you were with, some did, some didn't, but even still, we isolated. And nothing in human nature, whether you're an introvert or an extrovert, nothing in human nature is normal about isolating to the degree that we did as a country and as a, I guess as a world, for 2 years. And it's natural for there to be some trail on after effects from that length of isolation that we're only sort of starting to learn. Even me, and I'm sort of a mild extrovert, probably maybe even more toward introversion after COVID. And it was because I can still get up on a stage, or I can have this type of conversation with you, no problem. Or if you and I are together in a, you know, in a spot, maybe the sweet pool that I saw on your Facebook, by the way, show that to my kids. If you guys don't know, check out Jacob's Facebook page and look at this pool. And I normally never call out things that people have built, but I'm only calling it out because just the design and the scale of this thing is so epic that I had my three kids come over and look at it, which was a horrible mistake, by the way.
Yeah. When can we get one?
Yeah. So the general issue that I have run into is that now if I go to an event and I do anything but go like green room to stage, if I'm in a crowd full of people, I'm personally far less comfortable in that situation than I have ever been in my life, to the point where I recognize it. And I find myself wanting to sort of escape that situation because it's no longer comfortable for me. And that wasn't true before COVID. So there's definitely some things there, but getting back to your business, you said some things that are interesting because businesses that scale and end up, as you said, getting to the point where there's an exit value attached to it. And what has to be true there is it has to be solving a problem in a unique way that's profitable and attractive to a buyer at its core value. And what you're doing, as it seems, is you're taking the piece of telehealth, which is going nowhere, people. I'm telling you. We're going to go more in that direction. It's been happening for years. It started early with probably remote cardiac monitoring is one of the first things that sort of started trending people in this direction, where if you have a, you know, an arrhythmia issue with your heart, there's a device you can wear. And back in the day, it would be, you'd literally upload it to a phone. The data would go to somewhere else. Somebody in another state or country would then interpret that data and make sure that everything was normal about your heart. And then it just grew and grew with the explosion of the technological advances we have. But I think you're right. There's still a problem where when it comes to your health and meaningful change, there's something called the placebo effect. And it's often misunderstood because people think it only applies to pills or potions. It actually applies to interactions. There's something called a sham procedure where a physician can do something that's actually nothing. It's a show. And the patient can go in with a pain level of 7. On a scale of 1 to 10. And they'll leave with a pain level of 4, even though the physician didn't do anything. Why is that true? It's true because ultimately what many of us want is for someone to see us and to listen to us and to at least feel like we had someone that took an interest in helping us improve our health. So it seems to me that, and this sounds like a heavy lift, but it seems to me that what you're trying to do is to bridge the gap between nameless, faceless, impersonal care, and at least having a person or a group of people that folks can see consistently, even though they're maybe accessing the healthcare system in a slightly unusual way. Does that sound like a fair?
Yeah. And it's like, if you have a bunch of satellites, we'll call them, and you can go there and you can get a B12 shot, but you can also get your labs drawn. by those same people, and they're there every other week. You know, they aren't there 7 days a week. They're only there every other Tuesday, but they're 11:30 to 7:30. You know where they are. You know that there's going to be no wait. You know that there's enough staff there to get you in and out quickly. There isn't any appointments. And so if you're doing hormone therapy with us, right, and you live in Kentucky and you don't want to drive to LabCorp, which is 25 minutes away, but you come to see us for your B12 already, you can have your labs drawn by the same staff that's giving you your B12 shot. So you knock it all out in one spot. But then at the same time, I can go to Walmart, for example, and be like, hey, you know, we have this medical product. We're doing, you know, vitamins and stuff like that. Walmart has a pharmacy, right? And they do flu shots and stuff like that. They don't compete with me. So I can go to them as a product, right? And I can put my staff in there 5 days a week offering the same things. And then there's an app that we're developing right now that would replace the EMR, the telehealth app. It's even got a social aspect in it. So any membership that you're paying for, whether it be weight loss, hormone therapy, whatever, it unlocks that community for you. So some of customer service gets handled by patients. Because if someone's just starting hormone therapy and it's a female, they can pop in there and be like, I'm having some spotting. I've been menopausal for 10 years. Is this normal? We don't have to handle that on our end with our staff, because 10 patients are going to answer in 30 seconds. Be like, I went through the same thing. Totally normal. You know, your hormones have been dormant for forever and we're messing with that machine. So it's normal that if we introduce hormones to it, it's going to start back up. And then they go back to sleep. You know, they don't have to deal with it the same way. And it's not on our end or a customer service expense, because they don't even tap our staff to get these answers. And so, you know, when you go to exit, you know, at the scale that I'm talking about, the people that are looking at buying us are looking at buying us to figure out how we incorporate with things they already have in their portfolio. They're buying our processes. They're buying our programs. They're buying our SOP. They're buying our staff, and they're buying our scalability, and the revenue that we generate pays for that deal. That's the way that it's done. And so they're looking at it and they're like, okay, if this PE firm is a healthcare private equity firm and they own 4,500 urgent cares, they can put what I'm doing in every lobby of their urgent care, and they change the way that people view their urgent care now.
Yeah.
Because they're coming to see this brand on the front side for stuff that's quick.
Well, and the other
now they're familiar with the urgent care. So what happens when they get sick?
Yeah, they're going to go back there. Yeah. The other thing that just from a pure business sense, the other thing that really stands out to me of what you're talking about, and to back up a couple steps, I'm always telling folks that really there's four different buyers that you're going to deal with. And I rank them in order of how lucrative an offer they're likely to give you. At the very top of that list is a strategic buyer. Now, a strategic buyer can be a competitor, or it can be, as you said, what is normally the second tier, which is still good, but not as good as a strategic, which is normally private equity family office. But sometimes a private equity family office is also a strategic buyer because of what they already own. And they're always going to be willing to pay an increase in multiple, because it's not usually about, you nailed it, it's not usually about the revenue financially that your company provides to a baseline. I mean, you can't be bleeding and hemorrhaging money. It's more about whatever you're doing is folded into their ecosystem. Does 1 + 1 = 3? Because if 1 + 1 = 3, that's where there's an alchemy and an arbitrage play, really, between what they can pay for you and what you're going to add to the overall top and bottom line of the organization. So nailed it. But the other thing that really stood out is when you talk about putting what you're doing at the front end or in conjunction with traditional healthcare, let's call it what it is. You're also in, I suppose, direct response marketing. You know, you would call that, you're increasing lifetime value of a customer. And a lot of medical professionals are very early on starting to think that way and understand that every patient has a lifetime value, the amount of money that you can generate from each patient. And I'm not trying to be jaded, folks. I'm just telling you the truth. Every industry, you have to try your best to understand how much every patient that walks in the door should be worth to you over, you know, the lifetime of the time you interact with them. And the more touch points that you can create with that patient, the stickier that you can make that relationship. And this is true whether it's, you know, a healthcare practice. It's true whether it's someone that's selling vitamins online, someone that's selling a service-based business product. It really doesn't matter. The game is you try to spend as little as you can to acquire a customer, but nonetheless, it's still going to cost you money. The most expensive piece is acquiring the customer. So naturally, you would want to try to extract as much value out of a customer that you've already paid for before that customer walks out the door. So as you're scaling this, I'm going to guess, and you talked about technology, so immediately my mind went to, that sounds like a really cool thing, but I'm going to guess that the bear trap in there that's hard to solve for is the HIPAA compliance data protection piece. But maybe it's that, or maybe it's others. But as you're building this and you know that you're building it to scale, which I love, an exit, which I love, by the way, what are some things that are happening or that have happened that you were like, dang gum, that was really hard. That was a really hard challenge.
I guess to walk it back one.
Yeah.
It's always people. I don't ever think it's on the hardest part. I don't ever think is on the technology side. I don't ever think it's on client acquisition. I don't think it's on any of that. I think the hardest part always is people. And I always see these companies and they want to scale really fast. And they make a lot of mistakes, I think, doing that. One, taking on partners. I think it's a mistake. Because 99% of the time, when you're incubating an idea, you got three people that are willing to throw money at this thing to have it come off the ground. The conversations are not, what's my lane? Because they just want to start this company, right? And they're all partners. We're going to be equal. We're all 33%. There's three of us. They don't know who the ops guy is. They don't know who the sales guy is. They don't know who the ideas guy is. And until they generate $3 million, no one cares. Once they hit 3 million gross at like a 40 margin, all of the sudden, they all want all of those jobs. And so, you know, up to that point, they're hiring as a committee. The managers, they're all, you know, picking them and selecting them. But at this point now, where do we go from here? You know, let's open up a new office in Houston. Well, who's going to run it? Well, we can just hire. No, you can't. It's, I wouldn't say it's impossible to hire externally for a new office, but I would say it's improbable that that office would thrive quickly. And so the thing that people or no one does, which they should do, is when you're hiring new people, there should be a carrot like, hey, we're looking at opening in Houston in a year and a half. If that's something you're interested in, the only people we're going to send down there are people that are perfect. So if you learn everything that we do the way that we do it, the package that you would get for going down to Houston and starting it is X, Y, and Z. Now it's on the table for everybody at your current locations. But hey, you know, if I knock this out of the park, I can move down to a new region and become a lead down there and have, you know, 30 of my own staff and generate, you know, my own $3, $4 million in revenue. And not everybody's going to be motivated by that. However, it solves 90% of your growth problems because you're not trying to have to teach somebody culture and stuff like that from a distance. You're sending somebody that already knows what you do the way that you do it. And I'll give you an example of a company that was very, very good at that, that grew very, very fast and had a very, very big sale to private equity. It's called Power Home Remodeling. And they're based out of Pennsylvania. These two guys started working at this window replacement company. And the guy that owned it ended up basically turning it over to those guys. And that was what they did. Is at a point where they were at, like, when they were doing close to $1 billion in revenue, they would take 25 people as a mix from a bunch of different offices and send them to Tampa to open it up. Do you know how fast they got off the ground? Instantly.
Man.
Because the marketers they sent down there have 2 years of doing this. They've been knocking doors. The sales guys they sent down there, these are big hitters. They got chosen as some of the top guys coming out of those old offices to move down and start a new one. Most people don't think like that because if I remove that person from those other regions, does that region take a hit? No, it produced those people.
Yeah.
So the system that you have built where you sent them away from it, that system can already reproduce that person. If you hang on to them, you actually choke your own business. And people don't look at scale like that because I don't want to blow up this office. You have to. That's how you get bigger. And so, you know, when you look at, take a medical business like mine that's just cash, for example. you were talking about the value of a person long-term. All of my stuff is very low cost, because with medical stuff, that's not, you know, cancer meds, where you could almost say it's elective if you want. They could stop doing that at any point if they feel like it's too expensive. The thing is, if they're coming to me for their vitamin injections, they use me for their hormone replacement, and we're doing an accountability program with them to change their relationship with food. Do you think my relationship with that person's on the table when money gets tough? My hooks are it. And it sounds negative in that tone, but that's what a good product does, is you want to be indispensable to the patient. So I don't charge a lot for any of those three things, but we make decent amount of money per patient if they're doing all three of those programs. You know, there's people in our pipeline that over the last 6 years have spent $20,000 on vitamin injections with us and nothing else. And if someone comes in to acquire me that's got a medical portfolio company, imagine if they turned insurance on.
Right.
I've got 50,000 patients in my database. They turn on concierge care and they turn on insurance billing and they continue offering PE, meds, hair loss, allergy, and all this other stuff. They'll 3 or 4x my revenue just on turning on insurance, and they'll retain cash. So the multiplier goes up into the 20s and 30s at that point, because my database of those patients, if they have all of these other medical offerings, they can just pile it on. And now they have a whole second type of revenue that they can pull from people that are already coming and seeing us for cash. And so people always ask all the time, you know, what type of businesses do you like to buy, or would you like to scale? I'm really big on recurring revenue, because I don't like to make the same.
I was going to say, you just described ARR in a nutshell. Yep.
Yeah. And it's, you know, on the vitamin injectables, there's no membership for that. But going in, they understand that it's something you have to continue to do.
Yep. It's built in.
Yeah. You know that if you're going to start this, in order for it to continue to work, you have to continue to do it. Now, you don't have to come every 2 weeks like you do when you start.
Right.
That maintenance, it might be every 6. But we know that's what has to happen. Whereas if I go to Subway, I can just decide I don't want to go to Subway anymore.
Right.
You know, I'm going to go eat Jimmy John's or Jersey Mike's instead.
Or Subway decides for you recently with all their closures.
Yeah. We're not doing this. and that's I get asked all the time, you know, what industry would you get in if I were you? I'm like, the industry doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It's all business.
It is.
But if you're looking at the way that you generate revenue, if you have to make the same sandwich twice or try and get the same person to come back to make them a second sandwich, it'll be a lot harder for you to scale. And like, you're familiar with roofing. Personally, that's not an industry I want anything to do with.
Yeah.
You know, how often do you need a roof?
Right. Exactly.
And how many people are in that industry? The thing about it is that I've got a lot of friends who own roofing businesses. I have lots of friends who own HVAC, plumbing, electrical. And what I notice is guys that own those are very content having 1 to 3 crews and doing like 4 or 5 million gross a year. It pays them a decent amount of money. Their contractors eat well. The problem is it's not sellable.
Yeah.
Essentially, you own a job. So you put all of this time in to turn 60 to find out that no one even is going to give you a 1x multiplier on it because you're an operator. And so if you're not putting in places, like my training stuff all runs through Trainual.
Yeah.
So anytime I change anything, I just type it into a thing.
It's a great program, by the way.
Yeah, I don't have to reprogram a book, nothing. But if someone comes in and wants to buy it, they know how I do my marketing. They know how I do my onboarding. They know how everybody greets everybody when they meet it. It's all the same. That's why Quick Trip and Chick-fil-A get so much credit for training good staff. They have good systems.
Yeah.
And so with like roofing and stuff like that, I'm outsourcing the work. So the guys that are on the roof doing all the installing, those are not my systems.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I have no control over whether or not the person doing the buying has a good experience. I'm just kind of the face of it. And so for me, something like that would be difficult to get into.
You make a great point. And yes, so home services is a space that I've just Forrest Gumped my way into. When you're in the exit planning business and you handle both the prep for an exit, which usually ideally takes at least 2 years. Sometimes you come in right at the point when somebody's like, no, I want to sell and I want to sell now. the caveat is always, okay, but there are going to be boxes that I know an ideal buyer of your business is going to want to see checked that you don't have checked. And as long as you and I both understand that and that we don't have time to fix it, I'm going to get you the best that I can, but it's absolutely going to be negatively impacted because these things aren't true. And you just hit on, in 7 minutes, you just hit on a whole bunch of really important things that I do want to call out to people. Businesses that have a higher than normal percentage compared to industry peers of annual recurring revenue, that's revenue that happens consistently more than once, they're going to sell for more because the annual recurring revenue portion is going to be counted with an increased weight than single one-time revenue. The other thing that matters that within annual recurring revenue is how long does the average person stay? So let's say you have a product that you're selling every 2 weeks, every month, every 90 days, whatever that is. The longer that you can keep each person buying that product, that's continuity, the longer that you can keep that person doing that, that's another check mark and that's another force multiplier and multiple multiplier when you go to exit. Some other things that you hit in a very brief period of time. When you're talking about Trainual and you're talking about your story of what you're doing and also the company that you know builds up people and then takes their very best and they move them to some other place to go and to start a new thing. Well, that's building a high performance culture. And that's the old adage that business owners, we've all done it at some point in our career, if we're honest. You can get a little scarcity minded and say to yourself, oh gosh, like what if I invest all of this in this person's training and development and turn them into a beast and they leave? And the question, it's not mine, I stole it from somebody who probably stole it from somebody else. But the question I always ask is, okay, cool, but what if you don't and they stay? How does that help you? And so high performance culture, making sure that you're building annual recurring revenue, stickiness of the product. And then the other piece that I thought was really interesting is if you know that you're going to exit, and tell me if this has been your experience, there are decisions that you will make that are different than decisions that you might make if you're not thinking that way or don't have a plan for it. The roofing is a great example. So the guys and gals that you just described, they're not thinking exit because there's about four tweaks they could make to have an exitable business. One, you nailed it. Don't sub things out. Grow to the point where you take less in the early years so that you actually directly employ the crews that are working for you. Because why? What does that do? That does allow you to build a pseudo proprietary system, but more importantly, it allows you to have quality control. And as you know, it's if it's Acme Roofing, this is the way Acme Roofing does every single roof consistently. They have trainuals, they have standards, they have measurement to see if their standards are being adhered to in terms of the way the roof is, you know, the initial shingles that are there are ripped off, the way that the house is staged before it happens to make sure there's no damage, the way that the underlayment is put specifically, the type of pipe boot fittings that they're putting on the roof, the way the shingles are laid, the way that they effort to eliminate waste. These are all things that they can do. The other thing that you're starting to see some smartness isn't just roofing. It's any service-based business. HVAC is doing this a lot now. Not as much plumbing, but you're starting to see folks put in sort of annual maintenance type products. Roofing is starting to do it, whether it's a roof wash or just an inspection. That becomes annual recurring revenue. It's usually not enormous, but what it does do is that it keeps a touch point with the customer and it solves for that problem that is a huge problem, not just in roofing, but in a lot of businesses, which is if you're a high ticket business or even if you're not, and most of your customer interactions are one time, that's a serious problem because you're always in this constant struggle and race to get new customers, which is, it just costs money. It's a solvable problem. It costs money. But the problem is that money, obviously, the more that you spend on the front end, whether you're using social media or if you're just using old school advertising, it doesn't really matter. Every time you get a new customer, if you can do business with them one time, that hurts you. So you're left forced to either try to increase the number of times that you can do business with them or raise the price of your products or hopefully beg for referrals, you know, if they know people, et cetera, et cetera. So what I love about what you unpacked is it really hits on a lot of the things that when I go in and I do an initial analysis of someone's business, when they say, hey, JB, I want to exit in the next, whatever, you know, 12, 24, 36 months. I'm like, okay, cool. Before we get started, I need you to understand and agree to fact that I'm for you. In fact, I'm so for you that I might be the only person in your life who has no agenda other than what you have told me you want and helping you to achieve it, which means there are going to be times when I'm going to say something that might tick you off. And I'm willing to do that and to tell you the truth, even if it makes you so mad that you want to fire me for a minute. Because the first time that you hear negatives about your business and your business model and the way that you're doing things should not be from a potential buyer. If that is the case, either you didn't hire the right person or anybody at all, or the person that is working for you is full of self-interest and didn't tell you the truth. Because you should already know going into staging for an exit, and there's a lot to it, you should know what they're going to use against you. You should already know it. You should know what the challenges are in your business. You've remediated the ones that you could to the best of your ability. And then, you know, you're moving forward. But this has popped up a couple times in this conversation. And what I'm curious about is, I agree with you, it's people. And I can't quite tell how old you are. I feel like we're probably roughly the same age. But
I just turned 41 in June.
Okay, yeah, so I'm 44. And you and I are in this weird sandwich generation, right? Where depending on who I talk to, I'm either a young Gen Xer or an old millennial, and there's not really agreement there. So I'm sort of in the middle. And I grew up in Maine, in a rural town, in a mill town, blue collar, you know, very poor background.
Yeah, I grew up on a farm.
Yeah. And if I'm honest, we were probably 20 years behind anybody else. So I have some influences really from, I would say, greatest generation, baby boomer, certainly Gen X, and even some millennial, some a weird mix. Everybody that you have a deep enough conversation with who's an employer, you know, the person who is ultimately responsible for hiring and bringing people on, whether they're, you know, personally in the trenches or not doing that, or they've delegated to somebody else. I'm hearing a lot lately the following. Kids these days, kids being anybody who's probably under the age of 28. And there's a lot of negativity. Some of that may be fair. Some of that may be earned. Some of that, I'm not sure if it's fair. I just think that they're a little bit different and you have to lead them differently. What has your experience been with hiring different age demographics? And do you think it makes a difference?
So I would say yes and no. And the reason why I say yes and no is because I honestly think the answer is industry specific. And industry is specific in a sense that I think there's a certain way that me as a business owner operates based on my experience operating business,
yep,
but also my ability to incorporate new technology into how we do things. And I don't care who you are or how open-minded you think you are, there's still a lot of, well, this is the way that we do things.
Right.
And the only way that I've been able to break that is I tell people the minute they get hired, I'm like, if you have a way that we can do this better, I want to know.
Yeah.
I don't care how long you've been here. I don't care how old you are. I don't know your experience level. I don't know things you're comfortable with. I don't know anything about you.
So you're giving permission from the jump.
Immediately.
Yep.
And I said, I'll promise you this. If we've tried it already, I'll tell you what happened and why it broke. And if you can figure out a way around it, we'll try it again. And two, if I say no, I'll explain why. Because I don't want to discourage anybody coming with me with an idea. Because if you get a short, curt no, it stifles it forever. They'll never come back.
Well, and that's the opposite of how you build the high-performance culture that you talked about earlier.
And it's one of the, I think the hardest thing for me outside of people was understanding that I can't do this stuff by myself.
Yes.
And I don't say that from a narcissistic standpoint where I feel like I have all the answers. But it's like, this is mine.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? So when I look at this and I don't have the answer and I have to bring other people in, initially it felt defeating because, oh, I couldn't solve that problem. Or this person's idea was better than mine. You know what? I might have a lot of really good ideas and a lot of good answers. They're not always the right one. However, the larger the table and the more ideas that get brought to me, the better chance I have of finding what the perfect answer is. And we could go really far on good. We go really far on good. But is it going to be the right one? Is it the perfect one? Is it most refined? And I think that the biggest mistake, and not to segue really quick, the biggest mistake I see people make when they start a business is by being the face of it.
Yeah.
You cannot sell a business you are the face of.
Preach.
Do not do it.
Oh, ever. Preach, brother. That's a huge pet peeve of mine.
And everybody's like, you know, I'm going to put my name on it. Please don't put your name in it. Don't put your face on anything. Please don't record the commercials. Please don't be in the Facebook videos. Please don't make people familiar with you. You're not the person that's, I'm not going to hand do anything with you if you come and work in my business. What I will sell you is the right person to do it.
Yeah.
That's the only thing I'm going to guarantee you. I'm not going to be the one to make the phone call. I'm not going to call you when something breaks. You're not going to deal with me. Like, that needs to be your stance as a business owner if you're going to open one. Because the biggest destroyer of multiples is you're the face of this business and we aren't going to have you.
I call that key man's prison.
Yeah, and you are. Because you put yourself in all this stuff. Now, what happens if this private equity firm that owns 17 other roofing companies wants to buy yours?
Yeah, you're staying.
We need you for 10 years.
Yep.
And the only way you're getting your 4X instead of your 2.5 is if you say yes. And you're not, you don't want to. And they know it.
You just, so essentially, you sold yourself a job. That's what I tell folks.
No, to go back to the question that you were asking, though, I don't ever feel anymore like I'm supposed to have the answer. I feel like I can go and find it, and I feel like I can source it. And I'll tell you straight to anybody's face, I'm not the most important person in my business. I'm important to the staff. I write the paychecks. But no one that does any business with us will ever know I'm alive.
Yeah.
And so that was the hardest thing for me was understanding I'm not going to be the face of it, understanding it's not my job to solve all the problems, understanding that I'm not supposed to be customer facing. Because, and again, I hired these people to do a job. I need to let them do it. If they can't do it, and I have to micromanage them, is that a them problem? Or is it a me problem? Because if I hired those people and they can't do the job that I hired them for, it's not their fault.
Right.
It's my fault. I picked the wrong person.
Well, that, or to what you said earlier, it's usually one of two things. You flat out hired the wrong person, or many organizations didn't train
their
them.
Systems.
They had no
their
training.
Their systems are not on par to bring them up to speed.
Yeah.
And with me, I know that my systems are good because that's the first thing you should develop.
Yeah.
The other thing too, when I go and speak places, and like, don't get me wrong, I'm not a guru. I don't have a mastermind. I don't have a product to sell anybody. There's no, people ask if I do personal coaching. I don't have a program. I don't do any, but I'll go and speak if people ask me to. And the one thing that I give in front and tell people is you need systems. Everybody, someone in the back will raise their hand and be like, I don't have any. And so I have this presentation where I break down systems and I don't tell them that that's what the talk is about.
Yeah.
So when I get up to open, I'm like, who in here like puts toothpaste on their toothbrush before water? You know, and you'll see some hands go up and they'll be like, who does water first? Other hands. And I'll be like, why? You know, and they'll be like, well, you know, growing up or whatever, I just felt like I got better suds. Like, okay. How many of you guys have moved recently? You'll see a couple hands go up. Within the last year and a half? Like, yeah. Do you go to the grocery store the same way that you did when you first moved in? Most people are like, no. Like, okay. What about getting dressed? Like, how many of you guys put right leg in first? And like, hands will go up. I'm like, guys, these are systems. You've been building systems since before you could walk. But when we talk about your business, all of a sudden you don't have a capability to build a system. You're doing all of the work.
They just overthink it.
But because people see this as some abstract thing. And it's not. It's what you're currently practicing. Yeah. And I'm like, look, when you go, let's say you mow lawns. Do you edge first? Well, no. Why not? Well, because this, and this. Okay. So your system begins with we mow first. We edge second. This is why. That's part of your system. And the great thing is when you start writing this down, you're going to find errors and holes. And the first edition will not be the first edition, or the first edition won't exist for very long because you'll constantly update them. The thing is, it has to exist in order for you to edit it. And so, you know, people are like, oh, I do HVAC, blah, blah. What do you do when you get up to the door? I knock. Do you have a greeting that you use? Yes. What is it? Oh, this, and this. Is there something you do with your shoes? Well, yeah. How come you can't write that down? You know, well, I'm just not good at putting stuff on pen to paper. Did you know that Google has a thing that will literally translate you talking?
Take a video of yourself and talk about it.
Like you take the translation that Google put that's super broken and you run it through ChatGPT, it'll fix it for you.
8 minutes.
It's all it takes. And those are the things that people are most afraid of.
Yes.
And it's because you can't, I don't know how to systemize. That's the first thing that you're going to, that they're going to ask for when you try and sell, is they're going to try and figure out what they're buying. Because your revenue is not replicable. Like, oh, you know, I did 3 million last year. Well, how? How? Well, we sell the jobs. Who sells it? I have sales guys. Like, do they all sell the same stuff? What's your pitch look like?
Yeah, what I always tell folks in a nutshell is that successful exits, what a buyer is looking for is to the and this is on a scale. It's a percentage, a confidence level, if you will. It's predictability of at least sustained, but ideally continuing to improve results, which is usually financial, what other metric there is, and confidence. Predictability leads to increased confidence. And if you, and the trick that I use, and it's a very simple one, but when folks come to me and they have a valuation in mind that I know based upon billions of dollars of transactions is way out of line with what they can realistically expect, I always do the same thing. I dig into the business and I say, all right, I want to do an exercise with you. It requires the tiniest little bit of imagination, but stay with me. Okay. And then I just say, I want you to put your mind in the eyes of a buyer. Put yourself in the state of mind of someone who's going to go out and acquire a business to add to what you're doing. And then I describe everything that is true in a blind way, as blind as possible, about their business. And I say, would you buy this business? And if I forced you to point out the problems with this business because you were going to have to write a check of the amount that they just told me, what would you say to me? And that little trick usually is enough for folks to bypass the, I call it homerism because I'm an athlete sports guy, the homerism of like, you know, no, our team is great and the refs are screwed. No, actually, wide receivers can't run routes. Quarterback can't read a defense for anything. Linebackers don't know what they're doing. It helps them to short circuit that and to be a little bit more critical and also to take it less personally, which is the hardest part of being a business owner, because in many ways, right or wrong, we're raising up children when we start a business, whether we think of it that way or not, and we're too close. And sometimes it can be really difficult to do that. But I did want to ask you this. This seems like a hard pivot, but it isn't. Hearing your story and the way that you think about business and just the energy that you have about business, I'm going to guess that you come from an athletic background.
Yeah.
Fair guess? Okay. Tell me about that.
I've always just been competitive. Yeah. I was doing boxing with my friends when I was like 5 in our basement.
That'd be child abuse now, but we'll let
Yeah, it. I mean, that was how I got started.
Like a
started.
Fight club, and toddler fight club.
I played football, basketball, golf. I swam.
Yeah.
I've kind of just been a person, if I wanted to go and do something, I did.
Yep.
And I wouldn't say that I have confidence because I was always very timid and stuff when I was younger. I didn't think I was the best at anything. But I always felt like I would figure it out. And it kind of grows into like the business thing. You know, when you take a step back and you want to do something, the main three things that you're looking for is you need stuff to be measurable, right? You need it to be repeatable. And you need to be predictable. And I feel like that plays a lot into sports. You know, if you want to scale, if you want to get great at something, you want to build a team, you know, you look at Moneyball. Moneyball's worked in every sport. There's not a single sport that Moneyball hasn't worked in. And it's worked on the highest level in European football, you know, with soccer players. You look at expected goals. You look at expected assists. You look at – and you go and buy the players that fit that model.
Yep.
And you win. You know, so when you look at some of the guys that were the greatest, right, Jordan, Kobe, whatever, those guys had serious character flaws.
Yeah.
Serious character.
You could argue that Brady did too, just in an unusual way.
Yeah, I think his were very masked.
Yeah.
You know, I used to host Jordan's birthday parties in Chicago. I didn't like him as a person. I just didn't.
Too intense.
You know? No, it was, it's just, he was very hypocritical about a lot of things. And he never took any interest in anybody or anything else. He was always very center focused. You know, are you a car person at all?
A little bit, yeah.
Okay, so the Mercedes SLR came out, and he was the first person in Chicago to get one.
Oh.
And it was parked up at the bar. It was for his birthday party. I walked up. We do a brief, you know, where he gives his rules and stuff like that. And I was 22, 21 at the time. And I was like, hey, man, that's a nice car. And his response was, I don't even know what I paid for it. It's like, I didn't fucking ask. Like that, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's clearly like, it's trying to tell you something.
Yeah, like it was a one-up. And I'm like, bro, I'm a 22-year-old white kid with like crazy clubber hair. Like, I don't, impressing me is not important. Believe
right.
me. You know, and we're running it down and he's like, no fans, no white people, white women are okay. I mean, it was just like a very weird wow. exchange. And we had it every time, you know, like we did a couple of R. Kelly's birthday parties. That was super
ooh.
Weird.
Ooh, I can only imagine.
But like they're, when you talk to them about stuff and you get down to their actual psyche, they got great at this stuff to overcome all of the things that they don't like about themselves. And when they get to this pedestal, now they can set rules to be whatever they want them to be.
Well, and I was going to say, because for so long, and so Jacob and I talked about this a little bit. We chatted briefly before and in different ways. Both of us have long been very comfortable. And he talked about it on this episode, not being the face of something. And for me, the nature of what I do as an advisor to a lot of folks that many of you know, when things go really badly, it benefited me to not be well known and to be behind the scenes. And so there's a lot of caginess that comes from that. But I will tell you this, having been around some of the most elite performers in sports, entertainment, more business, here's a trend that I do see, and I can relate to it. I'm not always proud of it, but I can relate to it. If you came from a life situation that whatever it was, you had to struggle, you had to face adversity. And here's the key. You felt somehow slighted, especially multiple times, or you were made to feel less than or told that you were less than. To that kind of person, one of two things happens. Some of those folks shrink away and they begin to believe that themselves and they live a life that ends up looking tragic and sad and they don't achieve a lot. Or a smaller number of those people were just wired a different kind of way where, to your point, we know that we're not the best. We know there are people that are better, but it pisses us off. And we use that as motivation. And I think when I look at a guy like a Jordan or a Brady, or certainly a Kobe, or in the business world, I think Pat Bet David is a good example of this. You notice that they tend to share this characteristic where it's like, every little thing that someone tells me I can't do, I'm going to put that in the bank. Like it's a valuable piece of currency. And I'm then going to use that to prove to you and to me and to any other MFer that wants to know that I'm him or I'm her and I'm going to go out there and do that. But the insidious part of that is the very same thing that can take that person, athlete, entertainer, business person, doesn't matter, me, the same thing that can help you to achieve incredible things in life. At some point you achieve them and it gets really hard to turn that off. And it's like to a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And there's always this part of you that feels, unless you do some really deep, like self-actualization work, there's just this part of you that always feels the need to look to make sure that others aren't slighting you because you've conditioned yourself to be motivated in that way. And to me, I look at all those folks that we just mentioned and I think they're different people in the way that they interact with others, but all of them, I think, could probably tell you every single person who told them they couldn't do something. You know what I mean?
And I mean, I align with that to a certain extent. And if you like do a deep dive into what I share on social media, I don't think people focus enough internal. It's like someone's like, I'm going to fix a problem. I'm going to go read about David Goggins. It's not going to help you. Like listening to him talk about the way that he ran 100 miles, even if you can draw some sort of a parallel to it, it's not you.
Because you're not that guy. Like not many people are that guy.
And even if you went through some of the stuff he did, the way that he got out of it isn't going to be your way out.
Yeah.
And a lot of people don't do enough internalizing of all those things. And I still struggle with self-worth now. You know, I had my nickname in high school was Chubbs. I wasn't even fat. I don't even know how I got that nickname. But I can tell you right now that sometimes I still struggle with it.
Sure.
Because of how much that I heard it. And like, this will probably come off wrong. There aren't many people that operate at the level that I do. At in any of my circles, there's plenty of people that have more money than I do that still don't operate on my level.
Yeah.
You know, some of them are so stupid. I don't even know how they got their money. And
that's better be lucky than good sometimes.
But, and so, and I tell people all the time, I'm like, there are plenty of dumb people that have done more than me.
Yeah.
And it's because they were not afraid to get started. I was, because I didn't think I knew it all, or I didn't think I was ready, and they were too stupid to know they weren't. And so they went ahead and did it anyway. And like, it may not last, you know, they may lose it all in the end. But the thing is they had blinders on and they didn't question anything. Was it lack of IQ? I don't know. But when I talk to people, they're shocked at how disciplined I am. And they're shocked about my schedule. And they're shocked about how very in the details I am about everything. And, you know, when people look at me, like I was telling you through Messenger, I mean, I'm 6 foot tall, I weigh 250. I'm covered in tattoos. I have a six pack. I drive Lamborghinis and Ferraris and Bentleys. And then when people talk to me, they're like, you're not who I thought you would be.
I could see that.
And it's like, I get it because like, I just enjoy those things.
Yeah.
But I'm not jacked because I do a bunch of steroids and I sit on benches and lift weights. I barely lift weights. I mean, I train for 40 times. I train for vertical jumps. I train for things that are measurable. Why? Because I can track that. It's a deadline for me. And if I can see my 40 time dropping off, then that means I'm not performing. It's like, I might not be able to lift the same weight 2 days in a row. That could just be fatigue. But like, if I'm training and my 40 time drops a tenth of a second, I'm doing something wrong. My form is broken. Maybe my head's coming up too fast. Maybe I'm not leaning. And I can dive into the details on that level of performance and I can fix it. If I can't bench 500 pounds today, it might just be I'm not having a good day.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I do. And what I love is that there's some consistency that I'm hearing in your life that I also see with most high performance people, where whether it's professionally and what you're doing in your business, whether it's your fitness, I'm going to guess this probably also translates to the relationships that you have in your life. There's a consistent approach that you take where you're really trying to be intentional about how you go about doing what you do. And to your point, and then we'll wrap it up. It's easy. Be careful who your heroes are, because it's easy to, especially maybe now more than ever. And I have three kids, so I have to be hyper aware of this. What folks present on the internet or on television or on the radio or even in public is not necessarily a full picture of who they are. And so the danger that we can get into is comparing our backstage with everybody else's front of stage. And so you and I had, we won't name him, it's irrelevant, but we had a conversation about a relatively well-known, I would suppose, a fitness influencer coach who we both know some things about that make one question if anything about him is real, but I won't even talk about that. Even if the person that we were talking about was as financially successful as he was, if you stipulated to that, the reason that I personally, and this is a me thing, I've got my own code like all of us do. The reason I still wouldn't respect that person is, to me, if I'm looking at you as a man, and this is not in a judgmental way, it's just in a how I grow to admire a person. If you're successful, for whatever that means for you in your career, and you're trying at it and you're getting better and you're improving, that's a check mark. But also, how do you treat other people? What kind of person are you to your family, whether that's your wife, you know, you as a husband, as a father, you know, what kind of relationship do you have with your kids? And here's the kicker. I always look for opportunities to see the way someone treats someone who has no power and can do nothing
help
for them.
Yeah.
That's always my, and I've killed business deals before on the golf course because of the way someone who I was golfing with treated the cart girl.
Yes, I have the same rules. You know, how do you treat people when no one's looking? And how do you treat people that can do absolutely nothing for you? two major things. And I didn't mean to cut you off. There's two things I wanted to bring up before you wrap it all up. One, going back to you, we're talking about like placebo effect in doctor's offices. Have you ever read Psycho-Cybernetics?
No.
So Psycho-Cybernetics, let me make sure I'm giving you, because every time we say the netics word, I'm like, please God, don't misquote it and have it be, you know what I'm talking about? It's not, we're not talking about Scientology.
You know.
I'm going to look this up. Yeah. So Psycho-Cybernetics, it's hyphenated. It was written by a guy named Maxwell Maltz back in the 60s.
Okay.
He was a plastic surgeon. And he noticed this phenomenon where someone who's a burn victim, 95% burn victim, would come in and have a skin graft. And they would walk out behaving like a whole new person. Like, and to him, it wasn't visibly noticeable that it, he made them better, right? But they had a skin graft and their confidence went to 1,000. Someone would come in like 9 times to get their face done. And every time they got done with the surgery, there was something else that was wrong. And he was like, I don't understand how a burn victim can have work done, have stuff not noticeably change, but who they were when they came out of the procedure was brand new. This other person that's like, they're shaving down a bump on their nose. Now they don't like their cheeks. Now they have a problem with their eyebrows. Now they don't like their lips. How does this burn victim have all of this confidence after this procedure, but this other person does not? So he went and found a psychologist or psychiatrist, can't remember which one, and they did a bunch of psychoanalysis on the way the brain is wired. And I butcher this every time. It's been a minute since I read the book. But the premise was they went into a third grade class. They took the math kids. People that got A's and B's, they got split off from everyone that got CDs and F's. And the CD and F people, they gave them A's for 8 weeks on everything without even grading it. Huh. They just gave them A's. When they assimilated them, 80% of the CD and F people were getting B's simply because they believed they could do math now.
Yeah, absolutely.
And they were kids. And so he was like, he goes, sometimes all people need to perform is a little bit of an affirmation that's possible. He was like, that is like the root cause of everybody's ability to do anything is having someone tell them that they can't. And I made a video on Facebook that I uploaded the other day. And I was like, sometimes your job in someone's life is just to tell them that they did a good job.
Yeah.
And to remind them how far they've come. Because they're so close to this corner of the painting that they're making right now that they still can't see all of it. And so like sometimes your job isn't to psychoanalyze them. Sometimes it's not to help them solve a problem. Sometimes it's not to troubleshoot anything. Sometimes it's just to tell them you've done a great job. You've come a really long way. You have permission to solve this problem on your own. And sometimes that's all people need. And the other book that I was going to mention too is called Positive Intelligence. It's by a guy named Shirzad Shamine. There's a test that you take online, 50 questions, rapid fire answer, and it kicks out a report that shows you your internal judges. And it's literally a book about how you talk to yourself.
Oh, I've heard
it. So
yep.
Are you a stickler? Are you judgmental? Are you a controller? Like all of these things. And you could be a 10 in all of them, which means you got a lot of work to do. But you can be a 10 in all of them. It's not a personality thing where you get shoved into a box. And I retake this test and reread this book a few times a year just to make sure that I haven't took a step back on my process of solving the way that I talk to myself. So if I could give two books to anybody that ever sees this, that's talking about running a business, growing a business, whatever, is pick both of those up. And start focusing internally about how you talk to yourself, because it will change how you talk to people. And it will change the way you manage people across the board. And you'll see a lot more personal growth in other people if you are better at communicating.
I love that, man. Thank you for sharing that. I have a reputation, folks who know me well in my circles, as sort of two things. One is sort of a Papa Bear personality, and you know, that's something that you grow into over time. And really what that comes from is I really do care, and I want people to be whatever the best version of themselves is, and it's different for every person. And the other is, it goes hand in hand with it, is I'm sort of the Don Rickles in most people's life, right? So those are new Don Rickles. He's my favorite comedian of all time, But Rickles was probably the master of just roasting. And I'm a New England guy, so some of that is well-earned. But the thing about Rickles was that it was never mean-spirited, and he never would do it if he didn't already have some sort of implicit social contract relationship where the other person knew that he cared about him and loved him, and he was just kind of giving him the business. And so I'm always very aware of that, that words have power, because in my life, you made a great point. You know, growing up as a kid with no dad and in tough circumstances, if there hadn't been people along the way in my life who at just the right moment just gave me a little word of encouragement and caused me to rethink my own expectations for myself and who I was, I wouldn't have made it. And so I would, like you, really, it means a lot to me to try to be that thing for other people. So appreciate that. There's one final question that I've gotten into the habit of asking every guest, because it's a question that someone asked me on a different podcast and I liked it. So if you could go back in time and you only had a minute and you could talk to, you know, pick your age, 13 to maybe 15 year old Jacob, and you just wanted to get, the opportunity to tell him just the most important things about what was going to happen, what would you tell him?
Nothing. I don't think I would tell him anything. I think you're a sum of all of your experiences. And everybody likes to do the time travel thing. You know, what advice would you give you or whatever? I wouldn't want to miss anything that I've been through. And talk about the butterfly effect. If I give him a piece of advice, it may honestly divert my life's path so far off where I wound up that I would be afraid to say anything at all. It would be one of those things where I it would be fun to be a fly on a wall. And you know how you watch like Back to the Future and they're like, don't interact with your, yeah, you know, the old version of you.
Yeah.
But like, I would love to bump into him and just have a short interaction, knowing what I do now, and watching something take place just to relive a similar, like the same thing that I went through in the past with what I know now, to see if I would have still handled it the same way if I were to go back and go through it again, just because I'm curious. But I honestly, I don't think I would give any advice. I don't think I would say anything sage. I would probably just be like, in life, if there's something that you want to go try, try it. Because the moment to do that fades quickly. And time gets shorter as you get older. So make sure that you use all of the time that you have towards things that fulfill you. And don't give your time away to stuff that doesn't. And that would probably be all I would say.
Pretty similar to my answer, man. My answer was, all I would say is, just know that it all works out in the end and it's going to be okay. And I say that, my kids ask all the time, because, you know, they know dad went through some really hard stuff in life. And they always ask, like, would you go back and change it? And the answer is always no, because I wouldn't likely have my children. I wouldn't have the perspective that I do. I wouldn't have the wife that I do. I wouldn't have had the privilege of being involved in so many businesses with so many cool people. So I wouldn't change a damn thing. So love the answer. Thank you so much for being so generous with your time and sharing with us. I really enjoyed it. And
you honestly took a guest on that you knew absolutely nothing about because someone else tagged you on it.
That's fun. I just said to my wife before this, I said, I know a few things about Jacob. I know that he doesn't like it when he parks far away from the door and people park right next to him, which I'm with you, by the way, because if someone's parking far away, folks, there's a reason. And if you go and park next to them, you're a psychopath. So I'm with him on this one. And then the other is that you like old books, which you referenced one today. So I was right there with you.
To qualify the parking far away thing, when you're somebody my size and you have a Lamborghini, it's because I need to open my door the whole way.
And get out.
It isn't because I'm not worried about your door dinging me. Yeah. I'm not parking on an island.
Dude, I have a Suburban and it's the same reason.
Yeah, I have to open my door the whole way and it goes 11 inches into the next parking spot.
That's it.
I'm out here just so I can get back
just
in.
Just trying to exist.
No other reason.
Yeah, same thing, man. I'm 6'3", and I have to open that door all the way or I don't fit out the door. So I'm right there with you.
100%.
Thank you, my friend, for the time. I appreciate you. And I'll put some links, if you're cool with it, as to where folks can maybe look you up on Instagram.